Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. Ooh, 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 ooh. And I'm feeling good.
So essentially how I got into film was when I was younger, I would make a lot of odd like iMovies and flip videos, and that kind of just, it always kind of stuck with me, just having a camera with me. And as I got into high school, we have a really good broadcasting program, so I just kind of attached to that and then got more into film. I really love film because for me, I'm a very like visual person, and I love putting my ideas in my head into something that people can watch and react to and have emotions and just experience the whole thing.
So I did my first show in the 7th grade over the summer. My best friend wanted to audition, and she dragged me along. I did not want to do it. It was for the show Into the Woods, and I got up on stage and I auditioned, and I forgot all of my words and I cried hysterically. They let me do it 3 times and I forgot the words every single time, and I ran out and I got the call later that I miraculously made it. And I went to the first rehearsal and the read through and everything, and I got in the car after my first rehearsal. My mom was like, "How was it?" And I was like, "That's where I belong. I never don't want to be on stage. I love it because it's new. It never gets boring." You know, like with a lot of different things that I had tried in the past that work for other people, like sports and writing and things like that, I got bored fast. But everything with theater is fresh and it's fast. And you never know what's gonna happen. And I just love that, you know, edge of your seat kind of feeling, whether you are an audience member or you're on stage. It's that feeling of newness and of fleeting beauty. Last year, we put on the production of Legally Blonde here at the high school, and it was right when I was being forced to decide what I wanted to in my life, start looking at colleges, decide what major I want to go down, what path I want to take. And I think I realized that I worked so hard, and every single day I came to rehearsal, and it was like right about when I was elected president for our theater board, and I realized that there was nothing else in the world that I could work so hard for. There was nothing else in the world that I would give up other high school things and being with my friends and my family and breathing and eating. There was nothing else in the world that I could imagine myself loving or doing as much as I do theater.
Well, both my older brothers played viola and cello, and I just thought it was so cool that they, you know, played in an orchestra. So, I mean, going down, it was cello, viola, and then, of course, I had to do violin, so. I always liked, you know, singing and jamming out in my house just by myself, and I've never really been a singer, so I felt like violin is my voice, and the way that a violin can express emotion is just so soulful and beautiful, and I feel like an opera singer when I play on stage. I always thought that the pit orchestra in a musical was the coolest thing in the world. Like, they're like ninjas that hide underground and make music. And I remember always seeing my older brothers play, you know, cello and viola in the pit orchestras, so seeing people perform on stage was so awesome, but I always loved the pit orchestra the most. I thought they were the coolest people in the world. So in 8th grade, I got the opportunity to play second violin in Frelinghuysen's production of Beauty and the Beast. I remember it was the final show and everyone was like crying because it was a really, everyone was like such a close family, and it was really sad to see every, you know, this show break apart, but we were also happy to be a part of it. And I remember in that moment thinking, like, this is something that I could do for the rest of my life because of how much I love it. And I've felt that way ever since when I play with an orchestra. I feel like I'm in my element and that this is like where I am truly happy.
My mom was always taking photos. She had a Canon 30D DSLR, and I always remember like seeing that when I was younger, and I'd always just kind of be like, hey, you should let me take photos. And she just let me take photos. Like, she trusted me as like 5-6 years old, like put the camera strap around me and be like, here you go, kiddo, have some fun. This is super cheesy, and I think a lot of people say this when they talk about photography. I really like keeping the memories. Like, you just look back on all these specific moments, and you're like, oh, wow, I remember when I did that. It's opened a lot of really cool opportunities for me, and I just like being able to create art like that and manipulate it in such an interesting way that you don't get through traditional art. Freshman year, I was pretty like, oh, photography's dope. Like, I like it. I like where this is going. I went in like specifically wanting to do photography, but then summer going into my sophomore year, I went to Vans Warped Tour, and I had signed up for this class with this concert photographer, Lisa Johnson, whom I love. Basically gave you a pass that let you go into the photography pit, which is the space in between the stage and the crowd for 3 different bands. So I was actually the last ticket for that class that she was doing. So basically we kept the photo pass like for the 3 bands. It was really, really cool. I was having a great time. And then once the class was over, we go back and they're like, oh, we're supposed to cut off the wristband. We were all just kind of like, please, like, can we keep them? And then Lisa, the photographer, she was like, they were really good. I think they should keep them. So we kept it for the entire day. And that pretty much jump-started my career.
So I distinctively remember reading this article. I don't know what it was or if this is even like true. I know some of it's true, but it was like out of the top films of like 2017, only like 2% of them were directed by women. And I was like, oh my God, that's astonishing. Like, that number is just crazy. Like, and I'm a naturally very like passive, kind of submissive, really nice person. So I was like, if this is such a cutthroat industry, how am I going to make it?
Oh yeah, I've been told no multiple times. Many, many people. Either my work isn't up to par, like I was too young. Being too young was a big one.
I mean, music in general is not exactly something that I think most people would go into, mostly because there's not a lot of opportunity, you know, jobs wise. I remember being afraid to tell anyone that this was something that I actually wanted to do, maybe for the rest of my life, professionally in a sense, because so many people that were close to me would tell me, oh, that's probably not a good idea since, you know, you can't get money from that job. Or it's not gonna be easy for you to find a job and you're just gonna end up, you know, struggling for the rest of your life. I actually remember a music teacher that I had, a conductor, this is like the weirdest thing. I don't think I've ever heard any other music conductor saying anything close to this, but he was a pianist. And right before we had a concert, he turned to the entire orchestra and he said, don't become musicians. Just don't become musicians. It's such a hard life, and you know, he said himself he wished he just did something easier. Like, that was so hard to hear because, you know, you dream of doing something so artistic and something that really makes you happy, and to hear someone like actually who's in the business tell you don't do it was so hard to hear.
So right around when I was auditioning for colleges, I auditioned for 14 live and 3 digital auditions. And I had my heart set on one school. I applied early decision and my audition went great. And everyone told me that it was the perfect fit. And I had people actually tell me that there's no way that I was not getting into that school. And then I got my rejection letter. And it actually felt like someone like punched me in the gut, in the heart, in the throat, like everywhere. Like it was this overarching like feeling of like doom. And there was a few moments in that day and the following days that I was like, I can't do this.
To recover from self-doubt, I usually try to just think in a positive way and just believe in myself, because if I don't think that way, then it's never actually going to happen. So yeah, just trying to have a good mindset about everything and putting yourself in the right spot definitely helps me get through them.
I think about the people who I've spoken to that have had the same doubts. Actresses that I know and I've been in shows with, I think about the times where they've come to me and said, I can't do this, I'm not prepared, I'm not good enough. And the things that I've actually said to them, the advice that I've given them.
Who's listening?
I've always found it very difficult to take my own advice, but I just have to remind myself of the things that I tell other people and that they really do apply to me.
I really like talk to a lot of people, like a lot of my friends were a huge, huge support system for me. Parents too. One thing that my grandpa always said to me, he was like, every time they knock you down, you get up one more time. So that's just kind of been a reoccurring thing for me. Like every time I get rejected, I'm just kind of like, all right, on to the next one. I don't need to have all the success in the world yet. It's not my time. It's gonna come when it's gonna come, and it'll be.
I guess at the end of the day, I would just remind myself, if anyone can do it, it's gonna be you. So at the same time, even though I always push myself down, I always am able to bring myself back up. And with music specifically, no matter how much I try to avoid it, it'll always come back to me. Like, I'll always feel kind of like empty without it, I guess. And that's when I realized maybe this is something that I should consider going to college and studying, because without it, I don't think I'd ever be sane.
I'd want my legacy to be a good one. I mean, I think everyone says that, but I want people to look back and be like, oh, she was always trying to help others. She was always working hard. She just kept working. Like, that's what I want my legacy to be. I don't want to be that person that everyone's just kind of like, oh, she had so much potential. I want them to see me and be like, oh, she really did something.
The thing that I've strived to do in theater and outside is just to spread kindness. And I think that whether you're in theater or you're out of theater, no matter who you are as a human being, that should be the goal, because that's all you need. You don't need to be famous. You don't need money. You don't need, you know, recognition for the work that you do. You need to be nice to other people, because then they'll be nice back. And that's how the world should work in my perfect world. And if someone were to think of me, whenever it is, that's what I hope that they would think of, is kindness.
I guess as a female, you know, to a certain degree, people expect a quota on the amount that you can put out into the world. And I just want people to remember me as someone who never stopped achieving, who just kept going, was like fearless, and I don't know. I don't want to be seen as much as that girl who played music, but as that musician.
I think if I had to leave behind like a legacy, it would definitely have to just be like loving kindness and just like peace and just like good vibes all around. I've never really felt like I've needed to make like change the world in a huge way, because I know it's not possible. But as long as whoever I touch with my life, if their life is improved by just my existence, that's all I really need to be satisfied with my life, and just knowing that like I can make a positive impact on others. that's really just my legacy, I guess.
Gotta wave to my fans.
I'm getting my bike back.
About your struggles.
Okay.
I know, it's like a
my
really...
struggles.
Okay, is that the question?
Yes.
Ned, can you repeat the question? What's the question again?
You won't. I keep forgetting the question.
What? I don't even know the question again.